Start with the pledge, please.
Let's roll.
I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, I believe we'll start with Ms. Coe. You're welcome. I was thinking of just putting you on the agenda as a permanent fixture.
I'm the public.
I know.
My voice is loud. It's the whole town.
It is.
I'm speaking for myself tonight, not the whole town of Simsbury.
Thank you.
I am here tonight to urge you to take the final step and incorporate a professional town manager in Simsbury's charter. At the last meeting, you heard testimony from Mansfield's town manager, Matt Hart, give testimony on the attributes of having a town manager. We will not be losing our ability to interact with the elected council and drive policy that would be in the best interest of the community. The town manager serves at the pleasure of the council. If the council manager form of government was detrimental to the town, to the policy of the town, why have town managers in Avon, Farmington lasting for over decades? In Avon, the chairman of the town council serves along with the council with no salary. We would not accept a person who only served as a PTO president as a superintendent of schools. Why an inexperienced elected official to manage a $90 million budget? At the present time, we have a first selectman with a political base that can get elected without any experience or knowledge in public policy, and an assistant, Tom Cook, who was hired by Mary Glassman through a headhunter as a labor attorney to finalize 13 union contracts and has morphed into a pseudo-town manager with no previous public administration credentials. Simsbury is no longer competitive with the surrounding towns. After revaluation, Simsbury's grand list was reduced 14.8%, and Avon's grand list was reduced 4%. The surrounding towns have lower mill rates. Simsbury residents pay the highest taxes in the valley. How can we attract business and home buyers with these impediments? The salaries of the selectman office is First Selectman Lisa Heavener, $75,000, Tom Cook, $124,508, Sean Kimball, $97,000, Eric Nome, $70,000, and Secretary Joanne Martin, $60,000, a total of $426,508. This is a base salary without benefits. Both Mary Glassman and Anita Miller were in favor of town manager in the past. I hope that their vote will be in favor of a professional town manager as the CEO of Simsbury with one voice and professional leadership. It is time to bite the bullet and move to a town manager council form of government for Simsbury. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Ms. Cox. Any other members of the public? No, I don't see anybody. The minutes of December 3rd, anybody have any corrections or comments?
Yeah, I did. No, I'm not going to have it in front of me.
Go over them.
I remember at the beginning of the meeting, somewhere in there, but I'm not exactly sure where, at the beginning of the meeting before Matt Hart started his presentation, I requested that we study the space of time between mandated charter revision commissions, and I don't see it in the minutes.
Okay.
Also, if I could just ask for the future.
I thought that was just not part of the record because it was, talking.
We had started the meeting. It was, it was an actual request for a future agenda item.
Okay.
And I would like to just ask a personal preference for seeing more comments from commissioners in the minutes.
Oh, more details?
Okay. Yeah.
Sarah? Melissa? I just have one change. On the first page, under action item, the first one seems to be B, probably because of the way the agenda went.
Mm-hmm.
But it said that Mr. Cook answered Commissioner Mylart's question, and it was actually my question.
Okay.
Not
Thank
to attribute
you.
To
Thank
Anita
you. That's,
any
no, that's
of my,
right. I thought, gee, I don't think I said that.
Anything else? No?
No.
Okay, anybody else? Any corrections or anything? Okay, moving on then. Just to clarify something, because I know two people have brought this up over the last few days. The reason we have it written up as discussion and possible action is because we don't necessarily have to vote today. It will depend on how the conversation goes and whether the committee as a whole feels that we're ready for the vote. If we're not, we're not going to vote on it. If we are, then we will. But it's not, you know, in stone that we're supposed to vote on this tonight. I know this is going to be a fairly wide-ranging conversation. I also plan on, instead of limiting the beginning of the conversation to just the form of town government, I know there was some discussion last week about possibly changing some other aspects of the charter to make different forms work. And I think we'll, you know, leave that open in this part of the conversation as well, because they're all kind of contingent upon each other. I don't think anything's out there isolated by itself. Okay? So it's going to be a fairly wide-ranging discussion, and we'll go from there. That being said, who would like to kick off the conversation about form of town government? Anybody? Okay, we're ready to vote.
You know, there are some commissions in town where we would really like your attitude. I will throw out what I threw out last time, that we take the director of personnel duties and put them under the professional, whatever we're going to call maybe the COO temporarily. Mm-hmm. And because of the continuity and the lack of political focus in that, and because I think the political focus of the first selectman, this is from my own personal experience, is that if staff didn't like you for some reason, and there's always somebody that doesn't like somebody, I mean, that's just human nature, I guess. They'll outweigh you until the next election, and that just can't be allowed to happen, I believe. There has to be somebody with consistency and professionalism in giving the personnel reviews and budgeting the, you know, the non-union benefits and that sort of thing. That, in particular, I would like to see moved out of the political realm and into the management realm.
You're talking about something more along the lines of an HR director, a formalized HR director?
Not necessarily. It could be HR duties that are written into the job description for the chief operating officer. Mm-hmm. Doesn't necessarily have to be an additional person at all.
Okay.
In fact, I think that would be really overkill.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But there are a lot of personnel related issues that just shouldn't have anything to do with politics. And delivery of customer service to the voters. And however, I think ultimately we would have to give some kind of ultimate oversight of the COO, you know, by the first selectman and the board of selectmen, if we're still calling them that. But as I said when I commented earlier, basically I had three jobs when I was first selectman. And I don't know if, I haven't even really checked to see if this is still the same way, but personnel director was one. Chief elected official was another, and the chief administrative officer was another. And so I'm talking really just about that one job at this point.
Okay. Yeah, one of the things that I've been thinking of when I looked at the charter, if I've got this right, is there's no real formal HR position in the charter. Like you say, it basically falls on the first select person. And if you set up, whatever you want to call them, set up a formal HR person who is outside of the selectmen, who would take care of all the administrative stuff, would be primarily responsible for dealing with contracts, etc., who would also do all the searches and setting up for interviews for positions that did come open and go through them. Eventually, you could funnel their choice or the last two choices, let's say, to the board of select persons. Okay.
Well, yes.
So this way you kind of feed it in, as opposed to the first select person saying, okay, we need a new public works director.
Right.
I'm going to hire them. What would happen is the HR person would put that out for, make a public notice on that, get the resumes, winnow it down if they could, and then make their recommendation to the board of select persons, who would then, in fact, finalize and approve that choice.
You know, it's not even as simple as what I said, because now that I'm thinking about different department heads, the very first thing I did when I was first selectman was hire a new police chief. The former police chief retired at that moment, and we it was a huge deal, because the police commission has a tremendous amount to say about who the police chief is. The Board of Selectmen has a tremendous amount to say about it. And we had these giant meetings, you know, where there were all these commissioners and selectmen and the candidates. And we finally narrowed it down to the last two candidates. Everybody en masse interviewed these two candidates. And quite frankly, if they can't take that kind of heat, they shouldn't be police chief. And it turned out with a very, very good product that he's still here. We've had 15 years of service from him, and it's been terrific. So that was a complicated process that took in much more than just the Board of Selectmen. I believe the library does a similar thing. You maybe know, I haven't hired a librarian. Are there any others?
Director of Finance.
Oh, Director of Finance. Yeah, yeah. Because a Director of Finance has to be totally independent of the Board of Selectmen. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So on the school side, the school business official is not a process that goes through the Board of Ed. The school business official is not appointed by the Board of Education. It's appointed by the superintendent, isn't it?
Right, superintendent. But superintendent obviously, you know, looks and
consults with the Board of Ed.
And consults with us, as we do with any administrative or central office.
But
or administrator.
The difference is the charter requires board action in addition to the recommendations.
Yes.
So there's a difference.
So we're talking about Section 502, duties of the first selectman. So right now, the first selectman is the personnel director, but that person has the option to appoint another town officer as the personnel director. That's how I read this clause.
Right.
And that's what currently is in place now. Right?
Does Tom qualify as a town officer?
That's what this 502 says.
Who signs the personnel reviews?
Depends on...
Do you know, Tom? Who signs the personnel reviews?
First selectman.
Yeah. Well, there you are.
Because the first selectman in this case hasn't delegated it to...
Partial delegation is where we are, right?
First selectman could.
So it says upon the first selectman may, with the consent of the board, appoint another town officer to the position of personnel director. Upon that appointment, that town officer shall perform the duties of the personnel director.
I guess so. The question to ask for discussion is, if we were to hire a chief administrative officer, if we were to hire someone, right now the chief executive officer of the town is elected. So that elected person comes with skills that the voters decide are important. But if we were to hire someone to run the town of Simsbury, what experience would we require? Would you want to make sure that someone doing the personnel reviews has experience in personnel reviews? Would you want to make sure someone hiring had experience in discrimination law, ADA law? You know, what protections would you want the person to have that was making decisions for the town? The way it's written now, the first selectman can hire someone to do that, or say, you know what, I can do it. It's not that hard. I'll just sit here and I'll just write the reviews. Not that, you know, we are always trying to make cases for worst case scenario,
sure.
In my opinion. You know, because we've been lucky and we've had a system that has worked. But the business of running government is much more complicated.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The way it's written now, it's the option of the elected official to say, you know, I will sign personnel forms. I will maybe follow the personnel rules, maybe not. We've had experience in our history where the personnel rules say you can carry over 10 days, but we've had cases where people have carried over 60 days or 50 days because there was no one who was tasked with the rules of following the law. So I think the question we should ask for discussion is, and maybe where counsel or Tom can help, is, you know, what are the risk management decisions that the town should protect to protect the town? And then once we know those, do we want to require that those are protected by a professional hired administrator, still allowing the voters to pick who they want to be the head of their community? Because that has worked very well. And I think we've heard a lot of conversations and our discussions at previous meetings has been, we like that. We like that part where, you know, the voters can go into the office of the first selectman and say, you know, I want to know why this isn't being done. So I don't know where we end up, but I do know that towns are exposed to a lot of risk, and they're exposed to a lot of opportunities to make a mistake that are very costly. And so what are those things that we want to protect the town while we have this chance sitting together to make sure that the town's protected? And then hopefully when we answer those questions, we'll end up with a place that we're comfortable with.
So in essence, find a way to codify, permanently codify, the role of the liability-inducing person in a protected, charter-protected position that can't be done away by the first selectman or the board of selectmen.
I think we need to say these important jobs that expose the town to liability, that need training, we want to put codify exactly what you said, in someone who has the experience we can hire to do that. So that, yes.
But that person should be able to be fired.
The person, but not that position.
Yeah.
I think that when you read it, Tom, it scares me a little because, mm-hmm. you know, someone could come in a board of selectmen and say, you know what, I can save that money. I'll eliminate that position. There's a lot of pressure on towns to save money. And, you know, why do we need a personnel director?
The tax collector isn't busy in June, so we'll just, you know, use her.
Why do we need a personnel director? I mean, I can hire and fire people, and that's where towns spend a lot of money because they make the wrong decision. And
well, I think that's where we went, going back to the conversation of last week, mm-hmm. and we were talking about do we want to codify it, and if we do want to, mm-hmm. are we better off doing it as an ordinance or doing it as part of the charter? And that's part of the conversation we were having last week. And I think we're kind of leaning in that direction to figure out, you know, what the balance is there. That's where I feel like going. I think when Tom read the part of the charter, I think it was more just to firm up what exists now as opposed to advocating for that position.
Right.
Okay, just to make sure we all understand it.
Yeah.
The other thing that I think we should be a little leery of is doing too much micromanaging. In the sense that we might just, and I'm just throwing this out, we might say, yeah, we should codify an HR director, et cetera, et cetera. But I don't know that in our recommendation to the Board of Selectmen for a charter change, we should specify that these are the specific qualifications they need to get in beyond a certain point, maybe, you know, an MBA or a BA, whatever it is.
Oh, no.
We don't want to go too far in that direction. I think that's part of that you have to leave up to the board itself.
You know, you may not want to go too far, but, you know, as I started focusing on this, you know, I thought the rubber's going to meet the road, we may vote. And as I got to thinking about what a vote might look like, I became kind of uncomfortable saying, you know, we could make a decision, yes or no, for this position, for a town manager, without really understanding the dynamics specifically for a Simsbury town manager and the council, and looking at some of the other towns. I mean, there's all kinds of variability there. And I don't see how we can make that judgment without knowing exactly what their roles will be and their interaction will be. So I mean, I know we have to come up with job descriptions after the fact, but that's after we open the door on a vote or close the door on a vote. And shouldn't we do some due diligence on the actual roles and interactions before we say, let's take a vote on it?
Yeah, that's where I had a problem, because we're trying to come up with a town manager. We really haven't defined what a town manager is, even though there are those pieces out. And looking at even the type of thing we heard from Matt Hart is there's all sorts of combinations, and it's got to match the town. And I think we really need to match the town and figure out the duties first. And then it will evolve into what we call them, whether they're a town manager and what the relationship would be with the board of selectmen and a first selectman.
Yeah, I'm not looking at it as we're specifically sitting here to decide we want a town manager, we don't want a town manager. I think part of the discussion is what changes do we feel is necessary for the town of Simsbury to get that we're comfortable with that will improve the town of Simsbury over time. I think, and whatever combination we happen to come up with, that's what we'll recommend. Now, whether that then goes to the board of selectmen select persons, I'm still trying to say that, goes to them, and then it wants to be put up before a town meeting for referendum, that's the next step. This is really going to be our recommendation, which is the direction we feel that would be the best thing for the town.
But, you know, and there is some confusion. I've had a couple of people ask me, does this necessarily have to go to referendum, or can a recommendation be made here and somewhere along the system get pushed aside or changed?
My understanding,
so
Bob?
I understood it must go to referendum. Is that correct?
Go new report to the Board of Selectmen. The Board of Selectmen can do three things with your report. They can accept it as stated. They can reject it as stated. Or they can send it back to you saying change the following. If it comes back to you, you can say, well, we like it the way it is, and send it back to them, and then they vote. Or you can make the changes they request. And then they, the Board of Selectmen, votes whether or not to send it on to referendum. It can't, you can't change the charter without a referendum. So it has to go to referendum.
Eventually. I agree with Ed. I think that we would need to see something to vote on. And I think what would be helpful tonight is if we talk about what concerns we have and what we want addressed, and then maybe Bob can draft some samples, you know, because I don't know what we call it. I know what we wanted to do, but, you know, maybe we can get some samples of town manager, chief administrative officer, some other things that we ultimately decide are important. And then we can have something to look at and vote on at our next meeting.
Oh, yeah, we could certainly discuss. I mean, that's what we have to discuss it.
Yeah,
and,
great.
And wherever we get to, whether it's this meeting, the next
right.
meeting,
okay.
the next meeting,
thanks, Helen.
Eventually we'll come up with something
great.
To vote on. Bob, you wanted to say something?
Hearing a desire for almost like an organizational chart more than charter language at this point, because you almost want to look at the total picture. Like we could do collectively, we do an organizational chart of the existing charter with the functions, you know, town of Simsbury, citizens, board of selectmen, first selectmen, and, you know, lay out the chart as it exists today. It's a little bit complicated when you do that because of the commission input to a lot of the appointments. Finance director, police chief, library director, sort of almost a commission form of government. And then we could do a version A of chief operating officer, and what does the first selectman role look like under that version? Full chief administrative officer, what does the first selectman, because if you think about it, the board of selectmen doesn't necessarily change all that much. It remains the legislative body of the town, unless you tell us you want to go back to town meeting form, modified town meeting, we could do that, but let's assume you don't tell us that. You have Board of Selectmen is the legislative body of the town. So you're really talking about, what do you do with the functions of the first selectman, and do you want to make any changes to how department heads are appointed and who they report to? Because right now, the finance director is, you know, very much works at the direction of the Board of Finance. It is difficult to envision a full town manager form of government where the town manager doesn't have full appointment authority for all directors, because that's where he or she derives their authority to govern the town. You know, and we could lay that out for you too. A full town manager, here's what it looks like. And you could make a choice as to what you would like language to implement. It seems to me, though, you need a total picture, and that
yes.
organizational chart to look at that. Because the language is it's not easy.
I have the current org chart with me.
Will you pass this out?
Courtesy
right.
of
yeah.
Oh, good.
That was,
so
well, that's been in our packet.
So we put verbiage around this.
Yeah, we could
really
put verbiage around
it,
some narrative and some description. Kind of annotate that, and then do one for version A, version B, however many you'd like to see.
But there's no functional delineation within the first selectman's office, for instance, the way I described it earlier, that there's three different tasks, for instance, and we don't envision how which ones the town manager would then take over and which ones would be kept under first selectman. So it's more of a functional organizational chart we need too.
Under a weak form of first selectman, the first selectman is the chief elected officer of the town and represents the town in all ceremonial activities or something to that effect. Here you have the first selectman is the chief elected official, but also chief administrative official. And I guess the chief operating officer, the chief chief administrative official probably captures chief operating officer, with some appointment authority, unilateral appointment authority, some appointment authority with input from commissions, and in some cases, no appointment authority over certain departments. And the other thing this charter doesn't have is doesn't have an identification of departments. Mm. And you know, we can do that too. It, last charter revision looked at that and said, we don't want to do that, leave it flexible. A lot of charters will say, you know, you shall have a director of finance with qualifications to be established by ordinance. You can do that as well. It seems to me you need a look at the organizational chart before you can evaluate language, because mm-hmm. language really implements the structure.
Exactly. Yeah, but you also need to talk about budget, and you need to talk about public policy.
Budget in terms of how much it's going to.
No, who writes it? Who implements it? Where does it
right
come
now,
from?
The Board of Finance is the
budget making.
Budget making authority. Lots of town manager form of government with boards of finance. The budget, the Board of Finance becomes an advisory board to the legislative body. That's another choice you'll have to make. You'll have to, if you like the Board of Finance the way it is, the full powers of a Board of Finance under the statute as the final say on the budget. The Board of Finance budget goes to referendum. In a whole lot of towns, it's the Board of Selectmen budget that goes to referendum. That's another choice you'll have to make.
In Granby is a town manager form of government. They have a Board of Selectmen with a first selectman, unpaid. Then they have a Board of Finance, and the budget still goes to the Board of Finance. Then it goes to referendum. That's the form that Granby has.
Glastonbury has a town manager, full town manager. Budget goes to the to the town council and the Board of Finance. Board of Finance makes recommendations to the town council, and the town council adopts or doesn't adopt, no referendum.
So that's
budget.
A modification.
Yeah, it's a recommended. The budget that is recommended to the town council comes from the Board of Finance, but ultimately it's the town council that adopts the budget from the town manager. The town manager is the one who puts pen to paper. So there's all these variations, and they're all.
Is there an opportunity to petition a referendum if
there is.
There's an objection to the
budget? Most charters have a petition process to referendum.
If there's no referendum, help them.
Yeah, and they have X number of days. But here you have automatic referendum, and you could tell us we don't like that anymore either, because you don't get the turnout or whatever. Again, that's a choice you would make.
If we take the simplest step, Tom, you're already doing duties that's not covered per the charter. Can we identify where there's an inconsistency between your duties and what the charter says now? Just to even to understand that process.
If you look at my job description, a lot of what I do is personnel work, certainly, but it goes much. Essentially, I'm also I operate in many respects as a chief of staff right there in the first selectman. I support the Board of Selectmen and all the policy stuff that they do. I work closely with Sean and Joe Mancini on preparation of the budget. The board. Just to be clear, the first selectman, there was never an actual delegation under the provision that Tom read earlier. But in most respects, that's I do a lot of the functions till it comes to the signature of the line. That's where Mary's right. That remains the first selectman.
Yeah, the signature on the line is that the final action necessary to implement whatever it is the first selectman. Then.
Right.
And Sean are basically.
But to go back to the current charter, are there areas where we're kind of out of sync of what you're doing that's not either covered in the charter that needs to be addressed?
The, of course, my role is not in the charter. And I think one of the real concerns is that when I first got here, at least I think part of Ms. Glassman's attempt to start to build a professional HR role. There was not an HR, there was not anybody at that point in the office with HR training. And I think that's and the charter doesn't require anyone to be in that role. That's the issue. So right now, I just happen to have that that's still a skill set, and she just happened to hire me. But that's, and I'm not, I don't know if I'm answering your question, but essentially, if you look at a large part of what's in that section 502, those are what I do day to day.
Which is allowable under the charter as long as the first selectman, the first selectman can hire as many assistants and staff as the board of selectmen allows him or her to hire. As long as the ultimate authority is still rests with the first selectman.
And to Bob's point, there are a lot of CEOs out there who have the responsibility for all these things who delegate them to professional HR staff. But there's no requirement in our charter for that.
One of the things that, sorry, Mary, just give me a second.
No, that's fine.
Is, and I sent an email yesterday on that, is the Erdman study that was paid for by the town. It was very thorough. And before, I think, any decisions are made, I would think the commissioners would want to at least read through that, because there were some very good findings there. And recommendations that I think might help if the issue is focused around personnel decisions. I'm not saying I agree with everything that was in there, but there was it was well thought out, it was well done, and I think it's worth at least reviewing, as well as, you know, the other things that we've already gotten, such as the charters, you know, from a number of towns and things like that.
When was that done, Paul?
The one I have is November 2014.
Oh, yeah. But it's new.
That's what Tom emailed to us earlier. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
I think early on.
Early. Yeah.
Right. And I read through it. I read through it initially.
Through the town.
I read through it again last night.
Through the town's email.
Yeah.
Or the night before in detail. And I think it's worth going over. Just like I read through the last night. I read through the. The town charters that we had, and I also went out and pulled down Granby's to go through that. So I think it's worth exploring and spending some time and going through it. If you know, and I think you know, some great observations have been made about you know, you really want to thoroughly go through it, see what some of the options are, and spend some more time saying, you know, which way do we want to go on something like this. And you know, we really have the opportunity to go through the whole gamut, keep it where it is, or to heck with it, change everything, you know, and everything in between. And I do think whatever we do, assuming it's approved by the Board of Selectmen, then has to go to not only referendum, but binding referendum, so that that referendum doesn't itself become advisory. I think you want to make it a binding referendum.
Can we go back to what I was talking about in the last meeting, was that my understanding about the town manager form of government having arisen in response to corruption and lack of qualified individuals, which I opine wasn't the case in Simsbury. But then we come to what Mary was talking about. So what are the problems that are facing Simsbury? We're talking about risk management. Mm-hmm. And the possibility that what we've done so far to ameliorate that risk could be done away with by a future
by a future
selectman or board of selectmen. So the problems facing Simsbury are not corruption and ineptitude, which is what drives the need for a town manager, but liability and the possibility of losing the form of liability protection that we've already come up with at Simsbury. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay.
The only I was going to say that the positions that were created to do what we all feel comfortable are being done now could be eliminated tomorrow.
Right.
They could be eliminated tomorrow.
That's what I mean by the protection.
And the other thing is, the one thing you have on the Board of Ed side, again, and maybe Lydia can speak to, is that the town hires a professional superintendent with skills to manage. The professional superintendent has the skills to manage, hire HR people and personnel directors. On the town side, the elected official has to have those skills that we ordinarily would hire, mm-hmm. because the elected person can choose not to hire those skills. And I guess that's, so yes, those are the conversations I think we have to have, and those are the recommendations, maybe samples that Bob could show us. Where are the structures that protect on the town side, still allowing an elected chief official, elected head of the town, but still putting those protections in to protect the town, those areas that cannot be eliminated? Because I do think it's important that the town have those skills and not be at the whim of.
No, that's where you get back to the codification.
And you still have to have it, that the fine line is, and I agree with what Mary has to say, is that so long as that person in that role doesn't feel like they're insulated from having to report to the first selectman and the board of selectmen or council, so that they then feel, I'm a protected class, I don't actually have to listen to you because my position is a charter position. So you have to, there has to be enough there that allows that first selectman or mayor or whoever who's elected by the voters to have some control over that person. Not complete, yeah. But just so there has to be some accountability.
And you reminded me of another point that Matt Hart made, that in order to attract professional staff, we want professional staff to know that they'll be reporting to both professional supervisor and elected body as well. So that was another point that Matt made, that a professional administrator would provide that assurance to.
I think it's important to distinguish between the person and the position. People need to be fired sometimes, but positions need to remain intact, so somebody else can be put into that position. The position of, whatever we want to call it, administrative person who handles these risk problems, would need to remain intact, but maybe the person doing that job isn't good. The elected officers, the board of selectmen, the mayor, whatever you want to call it, needs to be able to get rid of them if necessary.
Well, Bob, you could address that in the structure of these, Paul's concerns and Melissa's concerns as to who would ultimately hire the makes those decisions. So, yeah.
But if the charter creates a position that a town officer that serves for an indefinite term, that's when you start, the Connecticut labor law takes over and you have the just cause standard applies and we don't know how all that. But if it's for a definite term, that has a different set of rules attached. And you know, you could also set the term by the appointing, the action of appointing. But we could definitely do that. We could lay out, because the town officers in the charter, the charter does establish certain town officers now. They all serve for an indefinite term, which gives them the protection of Connecticut labor law. We could show you establish a model that would add a chief, basically Tom's job, to that and see what it looked like for your consideration with an organizational chart that shows you how it all fits together. But, you know, assuming that all the necessary functions are being performed right now under the charter, I think they are, what we're really talking about is reassigning existing functions and personnel to different appointing authorities and giving them status under the charter that they don't have today.
If I may, I'd also say that virtually all the charters we've looked at have very specific provisions for how you remove somebody from a role, whether that's a CAO role or a town manager role. That's got to be there.
Because the higher up you get in the hierarchy of discretion, the more ability you want, I think, to not have just a just cause standard, something a little bit more forceful, so that if someone is taking the town in a policy direction that the legislative body or the first electman doesn't want, they can make a policy change by changing the person with adequate protections, because if you don't have adequate protections, you won't get good people. They just won't take jobs that, you know, they don't have the sense of security in.
Can policy decisions be retained by the legislative body?
Oh, policy,
policy,
yeah, absolutely.
Don't put policy in the job description of the person.
Well, you do, but ultimately it goes, in many towns, final action goes to the legislative body. Town manager form goes to the legislative body.
It's not easy to draw that bright line.
I know.
Yeah. No, it's not, but you mostly see that in who
who writes the budget and who approves it? Because a lot of the policies,
right,
decisions.
There you are. It's right there in the budget. Right. That was my question earlier.
Yeah.
And by saying that the budget belongs to the Board of Finance, well, the budget is already so complicated and put together before it gets to the Board of Finance.
Right.
The people who have the real influence on the budget are the people who write the line items.
Yes, but you all know the Board of Finance here is.
Hey.
Hey, I'm with instructions.
Be careful where you're going with that now.
Board of Finance could say, we don't want to spend $1,000 on baseballs, we want to spend $500 on baseballs, and if that's the change they make in the budget that goes to referendum, then that's the budget.
And that's something the board, at least in the 18 years I was on, we never got into.
You don't do that. But you could.
I always believed in keeping it at a high level, at a macro level, unless forced to make a decision on some stuff.
Right.
But, you know, really, you want to look at the big things. And I think that's important, and I think you want to retain that ability to be the check and balance, because it gives you the check and balance that you need.
Yeah.
And that's why I think, you know, part of the reason we're working together, this town has the bond rating that it has, and it has the surplus that it has, and we're able to do things when we want to do things. So,
Bob, I assume you can write some language for, let's say, a position like that, which delineates, you know, reasons for just cause, et cetera, mm-hmm. which would give the Board of Select Persons enough flexibility mm-hmm. that if somebody went off in the wrong direction, they could say, hey, look, you have to do this, you're not doing this, and we've got to let you go, without, you know, specifically violating one line of a contract type of thing, where they've got some flexibility to get rid of them.
Yeah, we can definitely do that. It's never perfect because, you know, if there's a dispute.
That's why there are lawyers.
Right. But
thank the Lord.
I'm surrounded by this. I just plug in on TV.
Tom had his hand up before I did.
Might for tonight, maybe we could go in talk about pros and cons of just the town manager position itself. And I could take the lead on that and say that I think one of the pros is you're going to guarantee that the town is going to be professionally managed because you're going to hire somebody who's got all the professional qualifications. And I think another pro to that is that person's going to attract professional staff because they know that they're going to work for someone like that. So in the pro column, that's what I would put in there. But maybe people could add to that or add things in the con, and maybe we can start making this chart about just on that concept, so we can move this discussion forward on that.
Good suggestion.
Well, I'll add to a pro. If you might, one of the things that occurred to me was that if we had the town manager form, the two parties would have to compromise right up front rather than start knocking heads and sometimes getting nasty. I think that selection process could be more professional. Not that anybody ever got nasty.
One of the big takeaways from Matt's presentation that I had was the ability to do long-range planning. Mm. I thought that was significant. I mean, yes. Here's a town now that's faced with, you talk about risk management, then the Hartford suddenly ups and goes. So they have a financial risk and financial exposure now to the town. It's a huge gap we got to fill. In the absence of any long-range plan, you know, we don't have any options. I mean, we're kind of scrambling, which was the whole need for that economic development commission that was put into place. So for him to have a long-range plan and be able to be there for the long term, not just a two-year term or a four-year term, but to be able to look out over 10 years, knowing how long it takes things to get through budgets and through cycles and what have you, having that in place and knowing what we're trying to go to, that as things do come up, like a major taxpayer leaving, you've got some options, you can adjust and you can plan, but you know, the ultimate end state of what you're really trying to do stays in place, and I thought that was absolutely critical.
I think it's a great point.
Can I just comment one thing on what Bob said, and with respect to the Hartford, one of the things that we had thought about and not put it in writing, and not had public meetings around it, is what do you do if your largest taxpayer leaves, okay? Or what happens if the state all of a sudden says, you're not going to get what we told you, you're going to get $3 million less. And the things that would have occurred even though it was a long-range plan. But the things that probably would have occurred, and it would have taken the consulting with the Board of Education and with the first selectman, would have been each board has to reduce their budgets. That's it. Any discretionary spending's gone, okay? The second thing is that you would need to take money out of surplus. We got plenty of surplus. You know, we got close to $10 million. We're in good shape. You would take money out of surplus. The next thing you would do is you would, at your next budget, which assuming, you know, 12 months, something like that occurs within, you know, say halfway through. So you got a ride for 6 months. Is you would have to go to the voters and say, we're going to need a tax increase of a certain percentage if you want to maintain your services. Okay, so those three things would be your risk planning in what you would do. I mean, thankfully it wasn't something we needed to really just go for and do, but you know, in October 2011 when we had that storm, you know, we did take money out of surplus right away because we didn't have any federal funding, we didn't have any state funding, but yet we needed to act. We needed to get people in here to start mitigating all the tree damage and everything else. Mary worked extremely hard on that. The Board of Ed did a great job with the high school, and I think the Board of Finance stepped up by saying, here's the money, take it out of surplus, don't delay, get it done right away. So, but I agree, long-term planning is something that needs to be done. And you even with professional staff, you can't do it all by your own. You got to go out and spend money and get it done. But
stuff's going to happen, and then you adjust and you go forward. But
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the pro column, I would add peer network. One of the things Matt talked about is that there's a town manager association that they would never let me go to a meeting. Mm-hmm. So it was... It was hard for me to gain best practices as an elected official, and so we were able to hire Tom, and he got to go. But I think that's a tremendous asset that Town of Simsbury has missed out on, because you're not hearing about where the innovative ideas are coming from unless you can hire someone who's allowed into that group. But it's a very tight-knit group that shares information and practices.
Nationwide, which I thought was very important.
Nationwide.
Right. But I'll add to that, though, if I may. Sure. On the same token, we have CCM.
It's not the same level.
Weren't you chairman of CCM?
I was, but...
You didn't raise it up to that level?
But the difference...
Mary, come on, I'm shy.
The difference, off the record, nobody's here.
Yeah, okay.
The difference between CCM is a network of elected officials. And so you have elected officials that are ceremonial and chief administrative officers. So when you go to CCM, what you hear is ideas that you could take back to a town manager. But
so
you're never
you're
talking
with all
about
the politicians.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's a better way.
Okay, all right, thanks, Mary.
Lydia, yes.
Yeah, I think on the pro side, I'm just going to piggyback on a few things that even Mary had said. You know, you know, hiring two superintendents. You know, for us on the Board of Education side, I mean, we consider the superintendents, you know, as the CEOs of this organization. And considering the Board of Education budget is the largest, you know, the budget in the Town of Simsbury budget, so we would not think of not hiring someone to be at the top. I mean, and we're used to dealing with the superintendent, who is also part of Superintendents Association. So within that realm, we are accustomed to that hierarchy of hiring the best possible, and I know because we interview and even at the state level with the superintendent, so we know who's out there, what's out there. And then within that, I think someone had mentioned about not micromanaging, but also that is not our job as a board. I mean, we hire the superintendent, we are responsible for the three things in the Board of Education, and hiring superintendent, crafting the budget, and passing policy. And the superintendent, of course, you know, will hire central office staff, which will move along down. So there is already those areas in place, and we are used to doing that on day-by-day business as we move forward and meet. And I think in the pros part of it, too, is in the town, should we go forward with the town manager thing, having the town manager also working with superintendents. And I've asked superintendents around the state that also work with their town managers. Mm. And for many of the superintendents, the politics part is set aside. It is not there in a lot of their decisions. Whereas when you have an elected official, the politics can get into the middle and also muddle some of the decisions when it comes time, in particular budget time, when we do have to work together.
Anita, yes.
I would like to, since we're getting lots of pros here, I'd like to throw in, this is pro and con town manager.
Absolutely.
Okay. So, we're going to get to a few. I would like to throw in there that the people of Simsbury feel a very personal connection to our entire Board of Selectmen, but particularly the first selectman. And I think this is one thing which defines our town more than other towns that are around us. I feel more of a passionate connection to town government and town actions. And one time, for instance, I think this applies. I got a call from a statewide group, and they said, we want to do a seminar on Hartford and the suburbs, and we want to use Simsbury as an example. And I said, well, I don't know if Simsbury is a pure suburb. I think Simsbury is a town. And they were horrified. I mean, they thought we should be seeing ourselves as a satellite of Hartford, and that was the beginning and end of it. And they actually decided, because of my answer, that they really had to do this seminar. And now I'm as regional as anybody. I started a regional group when I was first selectman, and we've done a lot of things regionally. That's not the point. The point is that we have an identification, we have a character that we don't want to lose. We want to be seen as, I mean, look at this history here that you have in front of you. We started in 1670. There was somebody here that was creating something out of whole cloth that was not started somewhere else first. We have our own history, and we are who we are. We're not who we are only because we're connected to somebody else. This person said to me, well, how many of your people work in Hartford? And I said, the last statistic I heard like that was about 25%. And, well, how many jobs do you have in Hartford? And again, the last statistic I had was that Simsbury was a net employer. Mm-hmm. In other words, there are more jobs in Simsbury than people who hold jobs in Simsbury. And this person was totally shocked, because we have this kind of character that is more of a town, more whole, I would say, than a normal suburb. I don't want to lose that.
I have a question, totally out of ignorance. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the long-range planning. Doesn't the Board of Select Persons have a long-range planning subcommittee of any sort? Don't they do anything like that at all?
We have capital. I think
but
if you look at,
capital,
if you want,
in terms of policy.
But if you want to see Matt's long-range plan, you should get a copy of it. There's nobody who had the skills to do something like that. Mm-hmm. Simsbury.
He called it a strategic plan.
Yeah, strategic plan. Tom started it.
Yeah, we started
now under
right.
Tom, but before mm-hmm. Tom got there, there were really no.
And if you look at the successful models out there, and I think this goes to some of the concerns Alita raises, mm-hmm. the legislative body's got to be absolutely involved. That's the real key. And it mm-hmm. is in Matt's model, it is if you go to Farmington, in fact. That's where you make sure that whatever's happening in the town is being driven by the policymakers mm-hmm. and
right.
by the individuals in the chair. Because I'll tell you what, you start to buck the plan that the legislative bodies put together, it's going to be a problem. So I think that's one of the checks.
Well, that's with a comment about the board sets the direction, they set the mm-hmm. policy, and he serves at the pleasure of the board.
That's right.
So. I don't see that going away.
I have a con.
A con?
We choose the wrong person. We have contract termination costs. So that's one thing that I noted. A couple more pros. Addresses the risk management concerns that Mary raised.
and also, I think, will drive more merit-based performance on the staff of the town. Mm-hmm. They have a professional to report to, as opposed to the first select person.
I have another one, and I think it goes in both categories. We're supposed to do what the people want us to do. I think we've all got to get out there and talk more to people. I've asked a few people, how do you feel about it? They all like the customer service they get from a first selectman. But I suppose I could go out and ask five more people tomorrow, and I might get very different answers. So I'm not saying it belongs in pro or con, but I just think we've got to keep in mind we've got to do what they want us to do.
And I think Anita raises a good question. I think the question we should ask, however, is, are you in favor of the elected first selectman doing performance reviews of staff? And they'll probably say, what? That's what the first selectman does? Or are you in favor of the first selectman negotiating union contracts? Really? Is that what the first selectman does? I think the people of this town are very engaged in their government, and it, from the outside, it works. But going back to Lydia's point, the superintendent is making those day-to-day decisions that make the schools and the policy work. I don't think average person in Simsbury knows that the first selectman can come in and negotiate all the contracts, hire and fire people. They just assume that the town's protected by having professional people do it, because professional people do it in every place that I work or you work. You don't get hired to come in and make those decisions for your company. So I think people would be horrified if they knew that anyone who's elected, regardless of the skills, would make those decisions for the town. So it depends on how you ask the question.
Mary, doesn't the first selectman have the benefit of town council for this decision?
Not on a day-to-day basis.
Okay.
First selectman has the benefit of council when first selectman asks town council.
Got it. So the
I'm
first
sure Bob would be
have to
that.
Ask if it were appropriate if it were a copacetic person.
Okay. But on the day-to-day, for example, tracking, this is a simple example, but tracking vacation days,
mm-hmm.
tracking time off, how to deal with someone who has FMLA leave, or all the other new laws that have come out. Those have always been done by the first selectman.
Okay.
But are they today, though? Aren't they done by Tom?
They're not today,
Sean?
Because the first selectmen over time have chosen to hire professionals to do that. But we could,
right.
I guess what worries me is we could go back. I remember those days.
Those people would be eliminated due to budget concerns. Not that they're not there today, but that they
yes,
could be.
Yes, that's
eliminated.
Exactly right.
Well, we
right.
did have a personnel person when I was first selectman, and that person was eliminated by the person who succeeded me in the first selectman's office.
Okay,
so it's been done. It's been done in the past,
yeah. mm-hmm.
and it could be done again in the future. There's nothing that we haven't protected the town for those risk management areas, based on what we've done.
Yeah.
To Anita's point, I agree with the success of the relationship between the public and the first selectman. That's a very real thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a little puzzled thinking, even if you diminished some of the role of the first selectman, why couldn't you still maintain that relationship with the community?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people would still, they want somebody to go complain about, nice word.
Mm-hmm.
And you could still, the first selectman still could do that. Even if there were a town manager,
it's still an elected position.
It's still an elected position.
I mean, you
position,
voted. They voted for you, and they want to come and right. complain to you if they have a complaint or compliment you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see how we would diminish that relationship.
Well, I think it's how we handle it.
Well, that's true.
You know, I think it's so many times throughout all of the history of discussions for other charter commissions and so forth, this has largely been presented as an either-or choice. And I don't believe it needs to be. I think there's first selectman form of government over here, there's town manager form of government over here, and there is space in between where we could find a comfort level and try to keep all of the things that we want and get rid of all the things that we don't want. And I don't know what we call it, and it's going to be hard to suss out all of that. And I'm glad you started us on a tally sheet. But I think we agree, Ed. I think.
Well, that's where I was headed when I said we should define what we're going to vote for.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it is somewhat of an either or, though, because if I go get the education, master's in public administration, and I get a job at a town that's, I still have to report to somebody, and I'm not really running it, and a town spot opens up that I can actually achieve my professional goal. See you later. And I'm not even giving you the 2 years that that Matt talked about. I'm gone. So I think it is either or. You can't, you know, I used Bill Parcells, Robert Kraft analogy last meeting, but it's true. You can't tell somebody, you know, I want you to make the stew and I'm going to pick the ingredients for you. You know, you have to.
Well, it's either or for the administrative duty, but not necessarily for the relationship with the public. I mean, that's a big PR role, too. That's vital.
Well, I think that's really going to be defined by the person that wins the election.
That's
if you're
true.
A dynamic
that's
person,
true.
I mean, as Matt said, you're opening up the time for that person to concentrate on policy and community involvement and being the, you know, the receptacle of the town's, you know, opinions. So I think, we don't have to not give that person an office. You know, you can do what you want. You may find that you're going to attract retirees, you know, who will really get into the job and still roam the hallways here. So I think there's a way to do it without turning off, how we feel about that first select person.
I would agree that the town manager who's got the MPA who wants to do this professionally is not going to want to come under those circumstances. But to Anita's point of there being a vast space in between, there's something like what we have right now, which is we have the liability and the risk management that we need, but what we don't have is the protection for that right now. And you can still have the community figurehead, the COO role as a first selectman while codifying and protecting the role of the position that protects us from the liability from not knowing a labor law, not knowing personnel rules, pension things. Those types of things should, in my opinion, be in a protected position, whether it's a town manager who would do all of that or in separately designated officers that are in the charter to protect that. And that hybrid form is there.
I just think if you don't hire a town manager, you're going to get great people who are going to use this town as a proving ground, and then they're going to be leaving. You know, and you're defeating one of the major benefits of a town manager, is which you can have continuity through changes in administration if that person is competent. And they're going to learn and get better, and every day their job duty is, what can I do to make this town run better? How can I save money? How can I get my staff to be better? What kind of great people can I bring in? So, you know, if you just bring them short and just say, I know this is really what you want to do, but you do this, well, after a while, and you bang on your head against the wall, you're gonna take the first opportunity that comes along and you're gone. So if you want the very best people, you got to give them the opportunity to run it.
Here's a question, and I don't know the answer to this one. What kind of turnover do you typically have in the various departments in town? What kind of turnover do you have in your public works director, your chief of police, all the key departments? What kind of turnover do you have now because there's dissatisfaction with not having a professional person on top of them? And how well do you feel these departments are being run?
Not much.
No, I don't think that there's a lot of turnover. I think that because we have implemented the
administrative without town manager.
But I think that we've missed opportunities mm-hmm. That other towns with town managers have had.
Such as?
For example, the strategic planning, we don't have that. I think that we have implemented a lot of the risk management by accident because we didn't have, we knew that was important, so we implemented it, but other towns had done a lot of that earlier. Just thinking off the top of my head. Tom, you want to add anything else?
We've been growing this professionalism for 5 years, And we've had a lot of people who stayed on as that occurred. Mm-hmm. Long term, I don't know. At the same time, we've actually also had turnover retirements. We've probably had 8 out of 10, but a grand total of 11 unaffiliated employees in the town, which is probably another problem. the same CEO for longer than 2 years, guaranteed. I think it is an ongoing risk in terms of retaining professional people without some codification.
That being the case, without some codification.
Not necessarily without a town manager, but without some codification.
Right.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. I was going to say, from a strategic plan standpoint, I mean, there are, and Tom, I think I had given to you guys a strategic plan that was like that thick from a town in Maine and a couple of towns in Massachusetts, where we could have engaged in creating a strategic plan. The issue was two things. One, how much it costs. It's almost like a charrette type of thing, how much it cost. And then getting the people who wanted to spend, you know, hours and hours and hours working on something like that. And the fear that a strategic plan, while it's nice and it sits in the drawer, it faces the reality of what's really going on as far as things change. You know, 2008 happens, and all of a sudden, you're not paying attention to the strategic plan. You're paying attention to what's happening to your pension plan, and the fact that, you know, the investments are going down, and you got to make your ARC, you know, your annual required contribution, which Simsbury did through the help of, you know, the Mary and the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Education. But those are the things that you run up against when you have, what's my strategic plan? Well, that's great, but what's happening right now?
But I do think, I don't know who asked the question. You did.
Oh, and you have a six-year capital plan.
Yeah, but I do think that a first selectman proposing, for example, refinancing of when we refinanced the bonds.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a proposal to refinance the bonds. A town manager making that proposal would have been perceived as a financial recommendation. But the fact that it came from a first selectman, it was perceived as political, and we had to overcome some hurdles. We did do it, but
I don't think it's not political. I think we had to overcome, did it make financial
sense?
No,
but you weren't on the Board of Selectmen.
You're talking about the Board of Selectmen?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right.
So there,
I withdraw that.
So there's, it's just an example. But the point is, I think that, getting to Bob's point that he made earlier, I think that an initiative like a strategic plan, an initiative to do something is always perceived politically when it comes from mm-hmm. an elected official, where there may or may not be politics, or people may say, well, I don't want to give that initiative. I don't want to endorse that initiative because it could be used politically. And I understand that, and that's why I think the value of a town manager recommending it takes that politics out of it. Just like a superintendent proposing a policy is never perceived as political. It's perceived as a superintendent policy, and we'll take it or not, accept it or not, based on the proposal. But you do have that struggle when you have the person who's running the day-to-day operations also being political, because every recommendation that comes out of the first selectman's office, by definition, struggles with that. Is it a political? And in fairness to the other members, they don't know. You know, are you recommending this because you want to get reelected? Is this in your political hat? Or are you recommending this because you did go to a meeting with a bunch of town managers, and that's what every other town is doing, and it's good best practices. And I don't think people know how to, they don't know what the recommendation of the first selectman means.
And that's where, and I agree partly with Mary on that point. That's why, you know, strategic plan, in my view, what we had presented costs money, because you're bringing in somebody from
exactly.
the outside
mm-hmm.
to look and say, here's what you might want to do, here's what's done in other towns. That's what drives up the cost.
Right. And you would feel more comfortable with someone from the outside running it than an elected official.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
I think what impressed me about Matt's
with consultation.
Lydia's nice. She had her hand up for a while.
Oh,
going back to what you were saying, we're talking about strategic plan, and going back to what you were saying, I mean, if you ask the average, you know, voter or constituent or resident in Simsbury, you know, and I've never been asked, you know, oh, what's a strategic plan for the town of Simsbury, but we, because the board drives a strategic plan for the Board of Education, and we have strategic plans for, you know, 5 years out. I mean, it is ingrained in what we do every single day. It is board driven with recommendation from superintendent. So when someone asks me, so what's a strategic plan for Simsbury Public Schools for the next year or 2 years, I can rattle that off because I know that, because that's what we work at. That is what, that is so concrete in our day-to-day operation. And it really gave me pause to think about, really, what is a strategic plan for the town of Simsbury? You know, should, when someone moves in here, I've never been asked that question, but I'd love to really know, what is our strategic plan? If someone's coming in with young children in here, I mean, I can answer the education piece of that because they're going to be putting their children in our public schools. But on the flip side of it, honestly, I can't answer that, you know, with the exception of working with Board of Finance, working with Board of Selectmen, you know, during budget process, but in reality, you know, to put my hands on something. So that gives me, I'm glad we're having this discussion because it gives me thought to think about that also for my own, you know, 15 seconds of should I have to, you know, answer that to someone.
Yeah, I just wanted to put in a word about clarifying terms. I've used the word political a lot tonight. A lot of other people around the table have used it. But I think we should realize sometimes we use it, we mean partisan, and sometimes we use it, we mean political in a more general kind of a way. And don't tell me that there aren't town managers who are political. They can be extremely political. They may not be partisan, but
how you survive.
Right. That's how you survive in a job for 25 years or whatever.
You're still subject to the whims of a partisan board of selectmen.
Yeah. So let's make sure that when we, if we buy into this, we know what we're buying. And I think, was it Tom who said earlier, you get a person, and that person is going to create the job. And the bright line that I said, you can't really draw a bright line between this kind of policy and that kind of policy. It's all a give and take. And the fact that you hire a professional doesn't mean that it's now going to be some kind of a, you know, yeah, some kind of an obelisk that we set up and, you know, that it becomes set in stone. It doesn't happen that way.
So I just want to also clarify, we're talking about strategic planning, which is important, but I think what Matt really focused on was not only did they create the plan, but as the town manager who was going to be there for the long term, he was able to implement the plan. And so as things happen, he can make adjustments. So a recession comes along or the Hartford leaves or what have you, he knows what the end game is, and he can look at what he has in front of him, can make the appropriate adjustments along the way, but he also knows he's going to be there for the long term and help drive what needs to happen. That's what I took away and I thought was very, very important, was the implementation aspects of it, because that's what he's been asked to do. The board sets the policy. It's his responsibility to implement that policy to make sure it gets what it is the board's looking to do.
I know there was just an article, I guess, in the Current recently, where a town manager from one of the
Newington.
He was ready to run after not that long a period of time. Then I guess he backed off on it.
I think I saw something today.
Right.
But there's no guarantee. Let's say you do go the town manager route. There's no guarantee that he's going to be there long term. It's like any other job.
Well, he
might see something else. He might want to move to where their wife is being relocated.
Or being on 3-year contracts, so he's on multiple 3-year contracts. We would have something similar here.
When you talk about for the long term, there's no guarantee. Obviously, it's a long term situation.
That's where the discussions. You know, you have to look at. You know. Okay, there's pros and there's cons to both, okay? And, you know, Simsbury's current form is not perfect, but a town manager form isn't a panacea either, you know? So that's what I think you have to look at. And I think it's important, and maybe we don't do it tonight, but I think you also have to look at not what are the cons of a town manager, but what are the pros of a first selectman? And look at those and say, how does that impact Simsbury? And the fact that Simsbury, and even Matt said, it depends upon the town and what you want and what is important to that town. And I think you also have to look at, from the standpoint of the pros of the current first selectman form of government, is what has that done for us as a community? What is it? What has that produced from the standpoint of, now I take it from a financial perspective, okay, you know, AAA bond rating, a very good surplus, but also looking at it from Money Magazine's number 9 count, we've got, you know, great open space, not only what the town's purchased, but what a private organization such as the Simsbury Land Trust has been able to do in cooperation with the town and produce, you know, save 1,000 acres of land. So those are the things I think from a pro standpoint you have to look at and say, you know, what makes sense? And is there something in between where you tweak, and I don't mean just, you know, you change a few commas and words here. I mean, you know, you make adjustments to what we currently have. And then if, you know, 5 years down the road, that's not working, then you could reconvene another charter commission and say, okay, we've got to make a further change to there. Because we've had, you know, what, 4 or 5 charter commissions in the last 20 years, and none of them have come close to even wanting to go to a town manager. And there's no hue and cry for it. I mean, I understand Mrs. Camo, or yeah, Mrs. Co, and what she does. And what she wants to happen. But by the same token, with all due respect, Joan, you got 100 votes in the last election. And everybody knows you want a town manager.
Right.
So, you know, you got to take all of that into context. So I think this is a great, healthy discussion, to be honest with you. And I think it's a discussion that we need to continue to have over the next couple of months and get supporting documents from, you know, what we've asked town council for, and really look at, you know, what are the things that that we want to do, and what are the pros of both, and what are the cons of both. So I think Tommy did a great job bringing that up.
Yeah, to your point, this, you know, I moved in here 2.5 years ago. I moved from Westport, which is a very successfully run Board of Selectmen town with a different type of legislature. Okay. And my question is, when we wanted to move up here, how many other towns did we even consider? Simsbury is a draw. Simsbury obviously has a reputation for being a very good town to live in. Part of it must be the way it's run. So the question is, if it is such a desirable town, what can you do to maybe tweak it? Do you have to make an entire change? Is there something so wrong that you need an entire change? Or is it something that can be tweaked when you've already got, obviously, a very good operating town? So.
But it's been lucky. You've been lucky. Well, you know, you had a good people running for boards and commissions. And
but
you
I
have people, you
luck.
Have, you had, you know, you had, were able to attract good staff. But it, you know, there were some decisions, some lawsuits, some things that the town had faced because we didn't have people in place that knew what they should have done. So there's been exposure.
There's
and
been some, but the town, or I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Go ahead.
So I think it would be naive for us to say, you know, it's a great town, we're doing great, so let's not change anything.
No, I'm not,
I know you're not suggesting, I'm just, that's just, I'm sharing that, because I do think that would be naive of us to do that.
Oh, yeah. No, I don't think anybody.
I don't think there's a naive person on this board.
Nobody thinks it's perfect.
We've all been around.
Oh, I took that position. I'm pretty naive.
I was taken to the extreme.
You know,
my point is this, basically. It's obviously has been a very well-run town. Out of sheer luck or whatever, it's a well-run town. And the thing is, can you tweak it and make it better, or do you have to make a sea change in the way it's operated? And that's what I think we're discussing, really.
Going back to the point of strategic planning, one of the things in our charge is to consider not just the form of government and not just the duties of the first selectman, but also to consider the terms of officers. So that could be, you know, maybe one of the, if we decide to ultimately retain the first selectman form of government, even if we go to some kind of hybrid, you know, maybe the first selectman should be a four-year position so that the first selectman can have a strategic plan, have time to implement it. The Board of Selectmen could be 2 years, could be 4 years. But if we decide that that strategic plan is so important to the role and yet we want to retain, that's one of the things, mm-hmm. one of the things we can consider. It's certainly in our charge to do.
Paul, on your point, the that's kind of the if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Right? That's kind of the theory of that. And I think Mary makes a good point that I think we have been a little lucky. The charge every day when I go to work is, you know, what can I do better today? How can I make my practice better? And, you know, I think that's the thing that we have to really think about with this town. And a member of the public that came here pointed out, you know, how some towns around us are thriving economically. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a wonderful town. It's a fantastic town. You know, the Banshell, Memorial Fields, I mean, we have fantastic things that are built largely through volunteerism. But people are retiring. Older people are moving away from town. You're not on the Board of Finance anymore. I'm not getting younger. You know, this is my first kind of volunteer position with the town on the political side. I'm not sure there's that many people that are going to continue to keep stepping up with the pressures that everyday society has on these families, you know, to raise their kids and keep their jobs. So if you have the opportunity to bring a town manager in, a dynamic person who's maybe turned around a town and then looks at a Simsbury and says, this is an opportunity of a lifetime and I'm going to do great things at that town and I'm going to make it more dynamic and I'm going to turn our downtown into something more than it is. Maybe, you know, I'm kind of fine in West Hartford Center. Maybe we don't want that. Maybe half the town residents don't want, but I'd like to see some juice down there. And that's all part of, I think, what a town manager could bring. So, mm-hmm. Not sure. I mean, if it's not broke, don't fix it camp.
I was going to let that slide until you said that again. But I learned early on, never let somebody put words in your mouth. So that's not what I was saying, that it ain't broke, don't fix it. It is that, you know, I believe that we can look to make some tweaks, adjust things, and if it is new, it better be better. I mean, that wasn't quite articulate enough, was it for you? I got that through? Okay. That it has to be new and improved. And if it isn't, then you are just, you know, making some changes. You're changing the curtains and, you know, you're doing a few minor things, but you're not structurally fixing it or changing it. And I do think you have to really look at that to say, is it new and is it improved? You know, I think this has been a healthy discussion. And, oh, by the way, I do appreciate the fact that this book was here. Mm-hmm. And I want you to know that I actually did read this book. When I first got on the Board of Finance, I actually got it and I read it. If you do have trouble sleeping, I would recommend it. This is a great book. But with all due respect to Mr. Wolcott, it does have some very good things in there that you want to read.
It was a gift from him.
Yes, I got a call this morning. Betty Wolcott had read the article in The Current about our deliberations, and she said, if I got enough copies up there, could we give a copy to everybody on the commission? And I already have my copy, so I don't have to carry it home. But it talks a lot about everything that we're talking about, right. And over the course of a long, long, long history. And so she was good enough to give these to each one of us.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Express that. Thank you, Richard.
Mm-hmm. I will. I'll pass that on.
Anybody else at this one? And we're obviously not voting on anything tonight. The other two items on the agenda actually were all tied into this. So if there's no other discussion, we're ready to adjourn.
Well, actually, would you tell me what is E? Are we just going to...
What's going to happen with E is I'm going to be away for the month of January. Mm. And Tom's going to be running the meetings. And Tom and myself and Matt Tom are going to sit down and figure out what we can plug in. It kind of was dependent on if we went in there with this tonight. What I'm going to do is I'd like to put this subject off until I get back in February. And we're going to come up with some of the smaller ancillary issues and maybe those will be the agenda items for the next meeting.
We suggest that Bob could prepare those documents for us to look at.
Sure.
In the meantime, okay, great.
I assume that, yes, absolutely.
Continued research.
I was going to say exactly what Meg, or what Mary said.
What's her name?
Who is she? Oh, what's her name?
How soon they forget.
HSB holiday party, my holiday party, and I want you to know I did not have anything to drink.
That explains everything.
Anybody else have anything tonight? And before we adjourn, everybody, Merry Christmas, Happy and Healthy New Year, you and your families.
Thank you.
And I will see you again in February, and you can deal with him next month.
Thank you.
Thanks, Adam.
We're here. Good job.
Mary said she saw you with Mario.
I know, I guess he has to talk to her.
That's what she said.
I said,
Mary came in and just, you know.